To begin this conversation, each panelist will speak to our first topic, how each of them got into the climate change, sustainability, or environmental sectors, and where they see Canada in 2050. So if you would, we would like to start with Faith.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for providing this opportunity to engage. Thank you to Pollution Pro. Really happy to be on the panel today. I'm coming today from the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. How I entered the space of sustainability and environment. I've always had a passion for sustainability, but I think having the opportunity to work at the federal level in public policy, specifically on climate change and energy files, is providing me the opportunity to learn so much about what as youth we can potentially do and our impact for the future of Canada. So for me, the future of Canada will really have to take in consideration what we want beyond 2030, beyond 2050 to look like, and our various approaches and various pathways we want to explore to reach those end goals. So if it's looking at more decarbonization pathways, electrification, CCUS, seeing what's feasible in terms of public policy and how do we translate those policy objectives objectively and to support our overall goals of reducing emissions, creating a more cleaner future and cleaner air for Canadians throughout from east to west coast. So really, I think the future of Canada is hopeful because we have great minds like everyone here today, and I'm really looking forward to engaging. So thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Faith. And if Beth, you'd like to also share your answer as well, that'd be wonderful.
Sure. Thank you, everybody, for having me. It's a great honor to be here with everybody and coming from the unceded territories of the Lekwungen peoples, otherwise known as Langford in British Columbia. We've seen floods here the past few weeks, and it's very apparent that climate change is very much happening here on the ground, and it's a terrifying time for our young people. So I'm glad to be able to given this platform to speak more. I started my kind of work with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, previously the Millennium Development Goals, back when I was 13, when I went to the United Nations. And this really stemmed from the moral standing that I had, that I felt like I needed to help elevate the voices of other young people working on global issues. And I think that everybody here has a responsibility in terms of their morals and their livelihoods to stand up for what they believe is right, and to be speaking out with the privilege in which we have. So that's where I'm coming from today. I'm really excited to be here. However, disappointed in kind of our projections, our climate projections for the future for 2030 and into 2050. I'm unsure really kind of what is our actual strategic plan here to getting to net zero by 2050. Other people on this panel are probably also kind of scratching their heads to see what actually is out there. And our climate projections are very much showing not a successful contribution towards 40 to 45% reduction from 2005 levels by 2030 and net zero by 2050. So we need strong turnaround from many different sectors, and youth absolutely have to be at the forefront of that. Every single person in vulnerable populations and across the world needs to have a seat at the table. So thank you again for having me.
Sure, thank you so much, Beth. And we will now go to Stella.
Hi, everyone. My name is Stella. And for my grade 6 science fair project way back in 2015, I tested our local river, the La Have River, for fecal bacteria. And this was just for a school science fair project. But after we got the results back and we realized that the river was really, really polluted, I wanted my mom to tell people to get out of the water and pull the car over. And we realized that this was a bigger issue that an 11-year-old shouldn't be trying to take on. So after talking with my mom, we agreed to have a Facebook page together. And this Facebook page, we thought maybe 50 people from the community would see it, and that would make little me happy. And it blew up and it went viral overnight. And then after a few years of a lot of speaking, a lot of council meetings, there's actually a $15.7 million cleanup plan for the river. So hopefully by 2023, we will be able to have a river without these illegal straight pipes, so no more people flushing their sewage into the river, and we'll be able to swim. And that'll be a really great day for our community. I really want my story to inspire other youth, other little girls, that no matter how old you are, you can create change for your community. Change is happening everywhere. Change is happening in Nova Scotia. With sea level rising, I see it here every day. Every time there's a hurricane or a storm, it's getting bigger, it's getting closer to my house. Our basement starts flooding. There's more water in our yard than usual. And this wasn't a thing that my mom faced when she was little living in the same area. So we kind of have to look at what we're doing wrong and fix that, because it's getting scary and it's getting scary quickly.
Most definitely, especially with looking at the importance of water, that is something to think about wholeheartedly for the future planning. Next, could we have Ricky discuss this question?
Sure thing. Loving what fellow panelists are sharing today, and thank you to all our guests for being here, and Badia and Najot for the introductions. Really appreciate that. The language piece I'll share a little bit more is sharing Uklama Amitla, translating the Blessed One in New Chonolf. My ancestry is Hupashas in New Chonolf, my mom's side. My father's ancestry is unknown. And I'm here located in New Chonolf territory today. Suma-as, Somas River, Port Alberni, BC. A very, very pleased to be here, and just really, really looking forward to the conversation today. And with that said, in thinking about why I got involved in this kind of work, it comes from multiple perspectives, a convergence of personal, Indigenous, scientific, from my studies, in the sense, in the value and the beauty of natural spaces in our environment, both as we may respect and give the land goes back to us, and as a reciprocal relationship that must be nourished. And I think about food sovereignty and the foods we receive, and it's taking care of that land, and the health of our land is the health of our people. So that being quite significant there. Moments of life of which I've been wandering in the outdoors and going for a walk, I find the most blissful moments is when I'm connected to nature and feeling at peace. I want to help sustain these ways of being. From my studies, I've learned that connections to nature can help tap into our intrinsic motivation and help us create and develop more fulfilling lives. So it's with nature. It is so essential. We're interconnected to the world around us. And I see clean energy, sustainability, the work that we're all doing is a part of sustaining that for a brighter future. So that's a little taste of why I'm involved. And for 2050, ideally, it's continuing to have more conversations like this. I think of the onset of the pandemic, climate crisis, extreme weather events. There's so much happening, and it can be quite depressing and upsetting. And it's like, what can we do? But it's coming to the table, coming to conversations like this, that we can formulate new ideas, innovate new solutions to the challenges that are presented to our generation. And we have the capability to make that change. And I'm excited to listen as much as I am to share with everyone today. And I really do believe that collectively we can help create a future that's more equitable, that's more sustainable by 2050.
Thank you, Ricky. And lastly, we will be talking with Helen.
Wonderful. Thanks so much. Thank you to Pollution Probe for hosting the space. It's really, really meaningful to me to kind of spotlight the work of young leaders in this way. And so really honored to be here and sharing space with all of you. So I'm calling in from the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples, and many other diverse First Nations and Inuit and Métis people, otherwise known as Toronto. And my background kind of coming into the climate and energy space is one that I think a lot of young people in our network now share, where I didn't come from a technical background or a technical degree or discipline. I actually came from an arts background, had done a lot of work with community grassroots organizations in Montreal where I studied, and And was working actually towards this path where I really was passionate about working in global migration policy. I really saw kind of the movement of people as and kind of securing the rights and dignity of people as something that was really passionate to me. And so coming out as a recent graduate and finding this opportunity at Student Energy, which was my first job and still my job now, I really didn't have much hope that I would kind of get selected or kind of be valued in my experiences and knowledge for that role. And I think it's a testament to youth-led organizations that really create space for young people with diverse sources of knowledge, different backgrounds, you know, kind of untypical degrees and experiences to kind of come into these roles and kind of trust them to really lead on solutions. And so that's really underlined what I've become really passionate about in my work is for a long time, I was very kind of intimidated by talking about clean energy and climate. I didn't feel like I kind of had the expertise to really speak to those topics. And over time, was really supported in the student energy community and kind of larger, I would say, kind of climate and youth community to trust kind of what I knew and what experiences and perspectives I was bringing as a young person and make the even the interconnections between obviously migration and climate. The interconnections are very, very obvious now. And, you know, back in at that time was less talked about. So kind of learning to kind of find your space. And that's maybe the piece that I'll kind of segue into 2050, what Canada looks like, is I think what we need now to really get to where Canada needs to be in 2050 is really thinking about how we're creating spaces. And spaces, for me and my role, has always been around spaces for youth to lead and be trusted and contribute in really meaningful ways that go beyond, you know, I call it kind of beyond a seat at the table, because it's more about kind of providing that next level of agency and really decision-making power that young people deserve as, you know, kind of the stewards of what the future will look like. And so what I'd like to see for Canada's future in 2050 is kind of three key things. I think we need a conversation reset around climate and clean energy and decarbonization. And that means getting really honest and really real about what has not worked, why we are not on track, why the world is not on track. I was at COP26 and, you know, there's been 26 or 27, I think, actually technically COPs, and we're still not on track. And so we need to get really, really real, kind of beyond these like nice commitments and nice statements, and talk about why it's not working. And that means a widening of the tent on who's part of those conversations as well, which creates more accountability. As you bring more people into this conversation, there's more accountability for people to really kind of hold our leaders to account, ask the right questions, and ultimately make climate and clean energy a nonpartisan issue. This needs to extend beyond political cycles, and all of these kind of decisions and commitments being made cannot be at the risk of, you know, being lost as soon as kind of a new political cycle comes into place. The second piece is a justice reset. We heard that really strongly at COP this year, actually, but obviously we've been hearing this from communities in the climate and nature space for, you know, time unknown. And so really a justice reset where we look more critically at kind of the rights of nature, spotlighting those most vulnerable and those who have been stewards of protecting land and nature, and really committing to supporting those most vulnerable through kind of loss and damage mechanisms, whether that's overseas or kind of domestically as well, I would say. How are we prioritizing those who are being affected now? And then finally, participation. So how are we really making sure that, you know, we're not just committing to X number of like green jobs, but we're also committing to education, capacity building, training. We're supporting young people who don't have access to formal education spaces to be able to participate in green jobs and opportunities. And we're also creating an environment where everyone can participate in clean energy opportunities, because that's something that I feel really passionately about, is there's so much to gain from like decentralization, digitalization, electrification, but we need to make that a participatory space. So it's not just a really small portion of the population who can participate and gain those benefits. So that's a lot of information, but that's my perspectives on Canada 2050.